Good morning, everybody. First, I want to apologize. I supposed to have a PowerPoint presentation, but for technical reason, it will not work. And my presentation is supposed to be very visual. But let me first record my appreciation to African Center of Strategic Studies for giving me this opportunity and to discuss this issue of civil-military relations. I know most of you are aware about this topic, and we are not going to invent the wheel because you are aware about it. It is just a matter of putting it into context and to have some of the lessons we can learn to improve this important issue of civil-military relations. The way I would like to organize my presentation, instead of defining, I think Joyce defined the civil-military relations, just to highlight some of the key elements of these civil-military relations. And I would like also to use, I think Raymond used it, the concept of social contract as a lens with which we can look at this civil-military relationship. Because social contract is so important as a framework for us to look to some of these issues. Then I will discuss briefly a bad case of this, the failure or absence of abrogation of social contract in the case of South Sudan. There's no other country except my country. So I need to use it as a good case study to explain this issue of social contract in terms of the civil and military relations. Then to look at the trend of this, the status of civil-military relations globally, but even Africa. Because that trend will help us to see, and I want to look at the issues of coup d'etat as a proxy of the quality of these civil-military relations. But is it very important why civil-military relations are very important? Because we will look at the impact of these coup d'etat on the growth and economic performance of a country. Then I want to conclude also with a good case study. I'm supposed to take some case studies, but I selected Namibia as a country with a certain history that actually resembling South Sudan, but managed to perform very well in terms of civil-military relations and some conclusions. So let me start first with the key elements of the civil-military relations. Three elements, three core parts of the civil-military relation that we need to keep in our mind. One, a clear separation between civilian and military powers and responsibility, because that separation is quite fundamental. And the second one, the accountability of armed forces to civilian authority. The third, the practice of transparency in the conduct of defense and security matters, because sometimes I feel these are key three things that we should remember always. Then, in the middle of these core elements, there is this issue of centrality of the control of armed forces as a fundamental pillars of the democratic governance and democracy. Because we look at civil-military relations as a cornerstone for this issue of democracy or democratization. And the last one, each country has its own context specificity, because these relationships are shaped by history, by social, economic, political factors, that necessarily we may not have the same pattern of relationships. Now, let me just want you to imagine a triangle, because I don't have PowerPoint, a triangle of people, military, and state. This is what I call the social contract, because when you talk about these relationships are quite important to be seen in totality. And the evolution of a state formation in Africa is shaped by the quality of this social contract. And important to know, the way we form the state itself is the way we engage with the people. And the anarchy is not the preferred choice. So you have to devolve, to delegate most of these powers of monopoly power to a state, and that state should have a responsibility towards its own people. That's the idea of social contract. And if you look at these three triangle, these relationships, you need to look at them carefully. Because any emphasis on one part of this relationship, whether between the military and the people, or between the people and the authority or the state, then you may not get the good balance, like what Joyce said, the balance of this one. And it is actually, it has been found, the conflict or the violent conflict can well be explained by the absence of social contract, not necessarily by the grievances and the greed as has been dominating the scene. And because some countries, they do have grievances, but they're stable. Some countries, they do have greed of the leaders, but they're stable. What sometimes can explain the variation in the performance and stability tends to be the absence or abrogation of social contract. Yes, I want you to focus on that issue of social contract as a key concept for us to look at there. But let me give you the case of South Sudan. I have a very, I wish you were to see the scene of South Sudan going to the independence, jubilation, people united, a very high intention of the international community to support South Sudan, with assumption as if independence itself was an end by itself. And people assume that the state is actually there, and there's a very clear relationship between this state that will function. But what happened, that South Sudan was formed by the way the north of Sudan was mistreating the south, as if providing a basis, as if these people, they may be able to govern themselves. People did not deepen the type of relationship between the people and the government, the people and the military. So what happened after this scapegoat, the Sudan is not there, then people of South Sudan could not govern themselves, simply because there was no a very clearly defined social contract. South Sudan is a bad case, but it's a good case for us to learn from, but it is not exceptional. It may happen to any country what we are seeing in South Sudan. The moment we don't strike that balance in the social contract or between the people, the state, and the military. But let me go to the trend of the year globally. What are we seeing in terms of the social contract? And the best way to look at civil-military relationship is the coup d'etat. A coup d'etat is actually abrogating a social contract, a stability, monopoly of violence. What we are seeing, a clear case of the decline of the coup d'etat over time. A good trend of the unsuccessful coup d'etat are increasing, and the successful coup d'etat are decreasing over time, globally, which is a good news. But if you go to Africa from 1950 up to 2010, Africa was having the highest number of coup d'etats, 169 coups, of which 51% actually very, very successful, 51% successful. That is the highest in the world. You compare it, for example, to Latin America, about 145 coup d'etats, and only 48% successful. But you can, so this is a very important trend that you need to look at. But even you go to Africa, you will see the following trend even in the sub-region, because you may need to see which region are prone for this coup d'etat. So if we divide Africa to West Africa, Central Africa, East Africa, and Southern Africa. West Africa, in the 60s, after the post-independence, immediately we saw a very high level of coup d'etat. But in the 70s and 90s, it declined slightly. But then in the 1990s, it reached about 53% of all the total coups in Africa. What we saw, if you take the Central Africa, we see a similar trend, but also increasing trend. It is only in East Africa we see a very positive trend. For example, they used to have about 27 of the coup d'etats in Africa, the total coup d'etats. But in the 90s until 2010, it declined to 17%. Where we are seeing a very positive trend is South Africa. I mean, Southern African countries, almost 22% in 60s. But recently, it has declined to 9%. So a very clear regional difference is where we are seeing a very positive trend. But in general, we are seeing coup d'etats are decreasing, but unsuccessful ones are even increasing, which shows also how the military is becoming assertive in terms of avoiding the failure of social contract. Now, why is it very important? Civil-military relations are very important. Most of the economies have found. I have a figure here showing the immediately after any coup d'etat, a very drastic change in the growth of the economy of a country. But many economies have shown in relation to institution, it's not about democracy, it's about institutions, but importantly, the rule of law have a very positive relationship with the growth of the country. So in actual fact, the security sector is so important when you talk about the economic development. Now, let me take the case of Namibia, a good case. It's a country that took its independence in 1990 for the liberation struggle, colonized. Namibia today is one of the healthiest economy in Africa. In terms of good governance, it's ranked number 6 by Moi Ibrahim Governance Index. Improving records of combating corruption, a good records of efficient institution, what is called CPIA, the World Bank, they have how to measure the quality of institutions and policies, is having one of the best CPIA. And have a very good records of the Freedom House score, very stable, peaceful, no coup d'etat, not even coup d'etat attempt, and no military influence, amazing, it is from 1990. So how can we explain this one? Simple, I want to explain it in this way. Again, I want you to look at this triangle of the social contract. Sorry, I need to envisage this one with me in absence of the. What happened in Namibia is very interesting. First, the military, very professional, is strategically effective. Professional and strategically effective. The government itself, the civil authority, very competent with strategic leadership. The people is strategically aware and conscious about, because these are the elements that will define the type of social contract that you can have. But let me go into details about what have we observed in Namibia. Historical factors. One, the colonial institution that they inherited were so strong. Although most of the colonial institutions are quite extractive, but Namibia was a good example of, they managed to make use of this institution to build the state. The liberation movement, the armed struggle, they forged a very good relationship between the liberation army and the people, depending so much on the people. And then the peace agreement itself affirm and strengthen this issue of relationship between the military and the army. And they enter into a very serious democratization process and constitutional making process, whereby some of these elements of the civil-military relations are well embodied in their institutions and the law. A very effective civil oversight and control of armed forces. And the political leadership and legitimacy. SWAPO, the liberation movement, actually was having a very strong tradition, even during the liberation, of civilian control of the armed forces through political parties, the party itself. And then a very clear case of transparency in the defense budget. And then the restructuring of the society itself. So SWAPO depoliticized ethnicity and forged a national identity around a shared values of the country. And then they managed the issue of transitional justice, how to deal with atrocities committed in the past, and in through reconciliation. But they came out with a very interesting national commitment that a total amnesty for all of them. And then the role of civil society, media, and press, effective in shaping this type of relationship. And the last, the UN, through the DDR also, they played a very important role in helping in forging this relationship. Let me conclude with the following: what are the lessons we can learn from these two case studies of South Sudan and Namibia? One, yeah, the centrality of trust and social cohesion. This is a very fundamental, because the social cohesion is a reflection of the engagement of the people with the state and even with the military. And we should not take this one for granted. And that's the idea of the essence of the issue of social contract. Second, the primacy of political legitimacy. Sometimes people focus delivering services can be a substitute for legitimacy. Legitimacy is bigger than that one. And then the third, political leadership. When you compare the two case studies of South Sudan and Namibia, really the political leadership is so important. SWAPO and SPLM, the Sudan People Liberation Movement, having a different strain of leadership that they provided during after the liberation. The other one, communication. Most of the conflict in most cases because of lack of communication. If you look at this social contract and the actors of this social contract, I mean in civil military relations, communication. Sometimes there's some perceived misunderstanding based on lack of information. And then the last one is the democratization and legal framework, which are very important in such a relationship. Let me stop here and thank you very much.